The other thing, there's two other pieces of equipment that it requesting to purchase as well. One is a power stretcher to raise and lower the stretcher. It doesn't load it into the back of the ambulance, but it raises and lowers it. Under ambulance regulations, whenever we move a patient, we have to lower that stretcher down. So essentially, for each call, they're raising and lowering that three times. And I believe it's possible that we could save an injury. I can't guarantee it, but I think it's possible we could save an injury. People are getting heavier today. So when we load a patient into the back of the ambulance, that stretcher has to be raised. When it comes out of the ambulance, it's in a raised position, so it has to be lowered. They bring the patient into the hospital in a lowered position, and then they have to raise it up to the level of the hospital bed for the transfer. So it's up and down with it. So by a power stretcher, it saves some wear and tear on the firefighter's back. The other piece of equipment is called the Lucas device, and I made some copies. I thought maybe you'd like to see them. Send them around both ways. I hope I have enough. The Lucas device performs automated compressions on a patient who's receiving CPR. So it gives timed compressions to the patient, the correct level and the correct amount of depth, and at the correct cycle. And it really increases survivability for a patient that's suffered a cardiac event. We've had it for a number of years, maybe 6 years now, and the current one we have has a broken support arm on it, and the cost to replace that support arm is cost prohibitive. It's just cheaper to buy a new unit. Not cheaper, but it's almost cheaper to buy a new unit. So we're proposing to trade that in and replace that broken unit. It gets used all the time. It's powered by compressed air that we use from one of our breathing air cylinders to power it. And unfortunately, it's used quite regularly. So, we would trade in our broken one to purchase that. One thing I did want to say is that it is possible for us to purchase a lighter duty chassis and stay within the budget. For this, we could purchase a pickup truck style chassis, and some of the departments around us have them. I know Linfield has one. Linfield's been having some trouble with theirs, and making the move from the lighter duty chassis to a heavier duty chassis was increased the reliability of the ambulance and also the service life of it. So that's why I recommend, that's why I'm here tonight to ask for that.
So questions?
Oh, I'm sorry.
I was just saying the total cost of what I was requesting is $25,626.60.
Rounded up to $26,000, right?
Yep.
Yep.
If I might. Also, where this is a capital item, FinCom can transfer the funds, but the chief can't spend them until town meeting has actually changed the capital plan, which fortunately is September 12th. And on September 12th, town meeting does not have free cash to use, or the chief wouldn't have to ask you. Free cash will not have been certified funds by September 12th, so it's effectively zero until it is.
Questions?
So personally, if I just talk personally, I think for this amount, saving more lives is a no-brainer. As part of our fiduciary obligation, I just want to ask. So, talk to us a little bit about the other option. If you didn't go with this, what was the other option?
We would probably look at a Ford pickup truck style chassis.
Yeah.
And it would just be a lighter duty chassis that carries the ambulance box.
Which you think over a longer term, maintenance of that would be more costly?
I do. I think we'd have more issues with front end issues. The van style that we had had a lot of issues with the front end. And I know that some of the departments that have that style is having issues with the engine that they're putting in the, and they're having trouble repairing it. You know, it's going back for service multiple times, not satisfactorily fixing the problem. But even if we didn't have that issue, be concerned about, because with a heavy-duty truck, it's heavy-duty brakes, it's heavy-duty axles, heavy-duty front end. And so when you have a lighter-duty truck that's your not overloaded, but approaching the maximums, that's when you put a lot of stress on brakes, transmission, and other running gear of the truck.
Great. Is this similar to what the water department has?
Yes.
How much less would the other one be? I mean, it's not just the $1,700, right? So it's a lot more than that.
It would probably be in the neighborhood of what I'm asking for tonight, in the $25,000 to $26,000 less.
For just the
chassis.
Okay.
Yeah. That.
Okay.
When you buy an ambulance, you select what the chassis is it's going to carry. Then you select the patient compartment area and that sort of thing. And the patient compartment can be put on different chassis. It could be put on a Ford pickup truck style. It could be put on a Dodge Ram style truck. It could be put on this international style. So those are the three basic choices. Most of them are on the internet right now. Most of them are on the international style or the Ford pickup truck style. I haven't seen any around here that are the Dodge Ram, but I've read about some departments that have used them in other parts of the country.
Okay. Have there been previous, specifically back injuries, as far as lifting patients, or is this a common industry injury when you don't have that power cot?
No, generally our injuries with the ambulance are carrying the patient downstairs and things like that. No, it's not common, but it does happen.
Sure.
And it's, we used to be able to, years ago, take the patient out of the back and drop the wheels and keep the patient up at a higher level and then bring them in. So now it's more up and down because of the ambulance regulations that have changed, and it's because patients have tipped over when they're on the stretcher and been injured. So that's why they're very strict on that requirement. So there's more raising and lowering. And it's been in effect for a number of years, but 20 years ago, you could conceivably do that.
Seems like a no-brainer to me.
Yeah.
Thought I'd ask.
What is the expected life on the Lucas device? Does that last normally a couple of years and then you replace it, or is it longer?
I would think it's going to last the life of the ambulance.
What's the expected life of the ambulance? Do you have a rule of thumb?
10 years. Yeah, 5 years first line, 5 years backup.
So it's $20,000 roughly less for the lighter chassis. So it's a question of you incurred $20,000 worth of maintenance over the course of 10 years.
Yeah. The other
thing. I assume lost time is more of the issue than maintenance cost and maintenance time, right?
Oh, sure. We've had both our primary and secondary ambulance down for maintenance and then have to borrow an ambulance.
So,
which,
so you can build that in.
Yeah, yeah. And, it's possible we could add another year onto the life of this, keep it for 6 years, and then the amortized cost is actually cheaper to do it this way. I don't think we'd be able to do it with a lighter-duty chassis. So if we didn't have the funds to replace it in a normal cycle, the cheaper one could be just B.
Is there a potential to go 6 and 12 then, or would it be?
There's a potential.
Yeah.
We have to look at it and see how it is, but there's a potential.
Yeah.
Yeah. I can tell you the heavier-duty chassis one, is our spare one, is in far better shape than when it's being ready to be traded in than the van style was. When the van style one reached that 10 years, it was
finished.
It was finished. Yes, yes, absolutely.
This seems to make great sense.
Mm-hmm.
All right, we have a motion to see if I get it correctly. Transfer $26,000 from the reserve fund to accounts, $1,700 for capital, $1,700 for capital for the ambulance purchase, $24,300 for capital for EMS ambulance equipment. Any motion?
So moved.
We have a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Ready for a vote? We have to do this on a roll call basis. So, Paul?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Vanessa?
Yes.
Mark votes yes. Anne?
Yeah.
So we are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 0.
Thank you very much.
Okay, so let's just do the paperwork. I wrote 7-0.
He just got off the line.
And the amount of $26,000. Thanks, Chris.
Thanks,
Chief.
Thank you.
Okay, next item, cash reserves policy. Hopefully everyone had a chance to review what Bob had sent out, probably just after our last meeting. The core of this was to change the policy from 5% as the level that we tried to maintain to a minimum target of 7. And I think you can see in the packet the actual changes are there, right?
Yeah.
And we cleaned up a couple of words so that our language is consistent. Any other comments on this? And do you have a copy of it? You may be on mute.
She's on.
So I don't have one in front of me.
Are you watching TV? Sorry.
I am watching TV, yes.
Zoom in.
Actually, if you check, do you have email access?
Yes.
Bob sent this out right after our last meeting. So.
Okay, I'm just trying to find
first week in August. Probably the 5th or 6th.
Finding it right away. But let me check again.
While Anne's checking, any other comments? And this is as we reviewed it at the last meeting. I just did it in a cleaned up version without chicken scratch.
So I think around that time that I would have expected, I got the email from Bob about the forecast changing the percentage projections, but I don't see the email with the. I do not see an email from around that time updating the policy statement, but I do remember what we discussed at the last meeting.
Your last meeting, Anne, was the 10th, so it would have been, I assume, within a couple of days after that. But
yeah, the only thing I see around that time is August 11th. You had sent an email about changing the forecast around state aid.
For whatever reason,
it's not in my inbox.
Okay.
Give me one second.
Yeah, because I don't know if I remember.
Yeah. I might have just sent it to the chair and the vice chair. I don't remember. It went out. Did you send out a packet today?
No.
Okay. And you'll have to look through the TV more closely.
Okay, very good.
Actually, I just sent it to you.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman? In the first paragraph of the policy, the draft policy, the underlined section, is that meant to be 5% or was that supposed to be amended to 7?
Thank you.
That was supposed to stay 5, not 10.
That's actually a new sentence.
Okay.
Oh.
Correct. So in other words, we're setting a minimum target of 7.
Yep.
And realizing that it may not always be at that level. And that if it ever were to drop below 5, we would consider that to be a more urgent situation and to take more faster, I don't want to use the word urgent, action.
Just
looking at this for the first time, I just had a question about the first paragraph. You've changed net available revenue to just the term revenue, and then at the end you refer to net available revenue. I was wondering if you intended that and if that was problematic.
Where do you see a reference to it?
So in the first paragraph, the very first sentence actually, instead of referring to net available revenue, you've scratched out net available and you just refer to revenue. And then you've taken out the whole net available revenue paragraph,
yep.
But then in the last, you say that
yep.
net available revenue will be calculated by town staff. I just didn't know if you wanted consistency in your language.
Yeah. We do, thank you.
Oh, yeah.
So we're
and just to explain the difference, when you used to have MSBA reimbursements on debt, it used to come in as revenue but go right out as a payment, so it really wasn't available for anything. So it didn't make sense to use it in any sense as revenue. We don't do that anymore. They will never do that again. So.
And have you received that email?
I have, yes, thank you.
Great.
Bob, can you perhaps explain the third bullet point to me? Added to the funding of any long-term liability, this will reduce the need for future contribution towards the pension. How does that work?
If, for instance, in, you know, let's say an annual town meeting, the finance committee wished to use free cash to fund some long-term liability, they could, and that would make sense. You have to be a little careful. You can't ever decrease your pension funding that's scheduled annually, but you can make a one-time additional payment at a town meeting. And same with OPEB, we have at least twice given extra money to OPEB other than what was budgeted because we had health insurance savings. So, you know, cash reserves are meant to be spent on one-time things as often as possible, and I would consider paying down more of a long-term liability rather than less to be a one-time thing.
Other comments? So I think then we want to review the document. I think we would accept the friendly suggestion to change the second to last sentence. So it'll now read, the last paragraph, first sentence now reads, the most recent set of certified financial statements will typically be used to calculate both cash reserves and revenue.
Mm-hmm.
So that deletes the two words net and available. And we have
motion to accept the policy as amended.
You have a second, please?
Second.
Second, Peter. Discussion? All those, oh, sorry.
All those not naming in. In.
Okay, we'll do this as a roll call to vote either yes or no on this as amended. So, Paul?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Vanessa?
Yes.
Mark? Yes. Ann?
Yes.
Thank you. So we are 700 to the new policy.
Sure. He's back.
He's right, you know.
So next on the agenda is discuss override, and then the following one is talking about kind of the warrant. So there are kind of two things we can do here. On the warrant, Article 8, if I'm not mistaken. And to make sure I understand, the way it's written is it says, to hear the reports of the Board of Selectmen, School Committee, Board of Library Trustees, and FinCom regarding the town's budgeting for future fiscal years, and to provide any advice or guidance or take any other action with respect thereto. So the focus of that is, the article is to hear the reports, correct?
Right.
So there's not actually any kind of voting that goes on at that. It's
up to
it's
the moderator. It's to hear the reports, but it's also to have a dialogue. It's not meant to just be in listening mode for town meeting.
Got it. But there's no expectation. In fact, there's an expectation there will not be any voting, correct?
I would say that's right.
Okay. So open it up to FinCom for the moment. Do you want to talk override? Do you want to go through the warrant and bring it up when we get to Article 8. Anybody have a preference?
I'll say just go through it.
I have a preference either way.
Yeah, it doesn't matter.
Same. Okay, my suggestion is why don't we just walk through the warrant?
Sure.
page six of our packet as a warrant outline. Ann, you don't have that with you, correct?
If you just sent her the packet.
No, I said I didn't send her the packet.
I'm not sure that I have the packet, actually.
Yeah, I don't have the packet to send.
I did get the documents from Mark with updated policy that we just voted on, but I don't think I got a packet today.
I'm sending her the packet right now.
Great, okay, thanks.
Packet is en route.
Excellent, thank you.
Stall.
How about if I talk about Article Three for a while?
Great, let's do that.
You can talk about it all.
Ann, Article Three is the capital plan, and there's a lot going on, in the famous words of someone, signifying nothing. I knew Dan.
Full of sound and fury.
The first part is FY17, $26,000 added to the capital plan for the FinCom reserve fund transfer that you just agreed to. So that is necessary. The next section is $610,600 added to the FY18 capital plan, which sounds like a great deal, and it is. But we also reduced the FY18 debt service budget by $637,500. So it's roughly offsetting. It's a little bit smaller, actually, than it was. And just to get to the reduction first, that was partly the Birch Meadow lighting phase reduced, or eliminated for that year, FY18. And also we had scheduled, starting in FY18, $2.7 million of debt for some school and town roofing projects. And after actually a couple discussions with the facilities director, he'd prefer to do them in much smaller pieces, one at a time, frankly. So they've been taken out of the debt schedule and put back into the capital plan. And actually, I think if you'll see the first one in FY18, the Parker roof repair is now put in as capital for $460,000 in FY18. The only item I would say really of note is $350,000 for Reading Memorial High School boilers. That is not something that's been in the capital plan before. It was suggested by the facilities department to add that in the next 3 to 5 years over the summer. But if we do it right away, meaning FY18, it's actually an energy efficiency move, so it'll save operating costs, so we might as well do it sooner than later. Otherwise, you can just see basically a lot of things coming and going, which is true about the entire capital plan. You'll see a lot of public works equipment. The net of public works is to reduce the FY18 funding, which they're fine with. We do have some funding that we're going to request at FY17 town meetings, plural. You can see right below on page 3 of the warrant report, $490,000 is a possible request in November, and we're certainly going to have to talk about that. We don't know what our free cash position is. We don't know what the override vote will be, so that'll be an open discussion, but that's right now the request. $125,000 of that is already in the facility's operating budget. It's just not called capital. That's the security systems evaluation. It seemed really to be capital upon reflection, and maybe it should have gone in that way last April, but I just didn't think of it at the time that way. So that's just a renaming. And then the rest is new, and the $210,000 for the loader has suddenly, unfortunately, become urgent. We are renting a piece of equipment for $15,000 a month starting 2 weeks ago. So the soonest we can buy that, the better. And if we had free cash in September 12th, I suggest we buy it then. But I don't want to really dip into the stabilization fund. And we've already signed a lease for a period of time. And then you can see there's a couple of smaller items. And then out on the next page in the warrant report in FY17, we've queued up just over $100,000 for April town meeting. And the reason that they're listed as April, not November, is it's work that would have no advantage to be approved in November versus April from a facilities department standpoint. It's some roof repair work on the West Side Fire Station, and that work can happen anytime. It doesn't have to happen at the summer, but it can't obviously happen during the winter. And then the masonry is something that facilities can queue up very quickly and also do really at any time, but not during the winter. So there's a lot of moving parts on capital. Again, depending on what free cash looks like, what the temperature of our financial climate is, this may be too much capital to ask for this current fiscal year, in which case we'll just reorganize it, but that 210,000 front-end loader is really important. And that was just moved up from FY19. It was scheduled, just it broke down faster than anyone expected. Any questions on Article 3? You'll also see at the back of the warrant report there is a full new capital plan for the general fund, just for what that's worth.
When we're in a position with a loader that we have to rent it for a period of time, where does that, rental come down as an expense?
Yeah.
And what's the term that we have for that?
I'm not honestly sure, but it's not just 30 days.
Got it.
It had to be longer than that,
okay.
Yeah.
But it's going to be waiting till November.
I was going to say, if it was a year, we'd have probably been better off just buying one. But they literally could not wait and not have one and continue their operations.
The 120,000 that you're pushing up to April,
yeah.
I mean, if we have a mild winter or anything like that, they wouldn't want to start it any sooner?
It's, you know, if we're in very good financial shape at November town meeting, we'd easily move it up to November, but Joe's best guess was he had no reason to need that money in November, wouldn't use it in November, but if it would save asking again in April, it might make sense. But he wouldn't go out and procure any of this stuff until late in the spring.
Yeah.
Other questions? Comments from anyone next time? No. Okay, we have a motion, please.
Motion to approve of Article 3 as stated.
And a second, please.
Second.
Dave. Comments, questions? Ready to vote. Okay, we'll do the roll call. Paul.
Yes.
Yeah, exactly, by line. Peter.
Yes.
Eric.
Yes.
David.
Yes.
Vanessa.
Yes.
Mark. Yes. Ann.
Yes.
We are 7-0-0, sorry.
Article 4, I'll speak on behalf of the assessors. I met with the board last night. They approved unanimously all their articles, 2-0, when there was one absent member. Article 4 suggests a change from $750 to $1,000, which at the time this was proposed was the highest allowed by the state. Under the Municipal Modernization Act, we believe that's going to be higher. It would be allowed to be higher. The last time the town moved a figure was from 500 to 750, and that was in 2010 when a surveyor of our nearby communities, not the 25 peers we talk about now, but just our neighbors, suggested 750 was the right number. I think all but one was at 750, and the other one, like us, was still at 500. So we moved it up. Some of those peers or some of those neighbors 2 years ago moved up to 1,000, and we just didn't notice, quite honestly. We didn't catch it. So this is just to catch us up again to our neighbors. Wakefield did this 3 years ago to 1,000. And just to give you an order of magnitude, this exemption is lost revenue. Just to be clear, it's revenue the town does not collect, and there's approximately 20 taxpayers that qualify annually for this program. The income limits and the asset limits are very, very modest. And this, the funding for this comes out of the assessor's overlay account. And again, I didn't mention it, they voted to approve this article as well as all the others.
Can you tell us what the assessor's overlay account is?
In terms of how much?
Well, what is it in general? What is it?
Big pot of money.
Okay, and its purpose is?
Its purpose is there's a lot, and when I say a lot, I mean several years' worth of outstanding litigation on taxes.
Got it.
And they have to hold money against that. The Municipal Modernization Bill just passed this summer. One of the proposals was to consolidate it into just one figure, as opposed to you had to hold money in for each year, and then you had to hold the maximum for each year, so there was no room for anything. Going back 5 or 6 years, a past board had run that up to what appeared to me to be $1 million surplus of what they would ever need.
Okay.
So in the last few years, they've worked that down to a much more reasonable level. The biggest single item is still past telecom disputes. We thought that had all been fixed by legislation, but the lawyers of the telecom were far smarter than the lawyers of the state, and they did not fully take care of all the loopholes, so there are still some issues in the past that have not been buttoned up, and that's a few hundred thousand dollars. Reading has actually joined 40 other communities in pursuing this legally. We actually hired someone through another town to try to settle this thing and get our money. So that's why they do set aside money. And we fund, I don't remember the amount, but we fund an amount in the overlay every year, and it goes up by 2.5% a year. I think it's around 400,000 right now annually that they have, just in case, because they always do get people who file for abatements. And again, in the first year, an abatement is lost revenue. You know, in the second year, it evens out as part of the 2.5.
Questions, comments? Anne, anything? Any questions?
Motion to approve Article 4.
You have a second?
Second.
Peter, discussion? Hearing, take the vote. Paul?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Vanessa?
Yes.
Mark? Yes. Ann?
Yes.
There are 700 on this as well.
Article 5 is, I don't know if this option is new, but we didn't know about it certainly. It's to inflation adjust or index that last number. So we won't have to be coming back to town meeting every 4 or 5 years unless we really choose to. As most of you probably know, CPI is a very low measure of real inflation, but it is what it is. This would at least index that number again, that $1,000, to climb some amount every year. But to be clear, it could go down. And that'll be up to the Board of Assessors by vote. But they actually don't have any flexibility. We did say at 100% fixed. So whatever the CPI does is what it will change. This is not the same index, but it's very similar to the one that the light department's dividend payment is set off of. And in the last 10 years, one of those years, it did go down. So a very minor financial issue, but just more of a housekeeping one.
Yep. So just to avoid two coming in the future.
I'm sorry, explain that again.
So
well, it indexes the number, so in theory, you don't ever have to come back to it because you can say to someone, well, we did it 1,000 at the time, which was reasonable, and now you're indexed against inflation. So we don't ever have to come back now. That doesn't mean we won't. But that's the theory.
And how was it before?
Just a flat number.
Just a flat
number. It just sat there. For many, many years at $500, then bumped $750, and now $1,000.
Okay. Makes sense.
And again, this is the same 20 to 22 individuals in town.
Yeah.
Further questions, comments?
It's going to be set. I mean, CPI is 2.1%. It's going to be $1,021.
Yep. Yep.
Okay. And do you do it to the nearest whole dollar?
The four assessors ago, when I started here 10 years ago, without exaggerating, used to use 12 decimal points in his math and presentations. So this is no trouble to the assessors. They are precise.
Double precision.
Motion to accept Article 5? Did I skip one? 5.
Yeah.
So moved.
Second from David. Discussion. Take a vote. Paul?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Vanessa?
Yes.
Mark? Yes. Ann?
Yes.
All right. Here we are. 700 again. Sorry.
Article 6, there's one slight difference in the way I might have described it in the past. Our assessors and I learned something in the last month. This is to reduce the interest rate from 8%, which it currently is, to 4% from any senior that qualifies. And again, it's a very tricky and challenging qualification to defer paying any property taxes as long as they live in their house. Far less than 20 people currently do that. Previously, I had stated, and we understood, or we being the assessor and I, not the treasurer, she knew better, that the interest rate could revert back to a higher number if you passed away while in your house. In fact, that is not the case. The interest rate does not go backwards at all. It, when you pass away in your house, it does go to a higher number. Currently, the number is 8% in town. It's 12% by the state once you pass away. This would change it to 4% by us and 12% if you passed away in your house. Then your state is liable. This just is a, you know, a slight benefit, again, for the very, very small, in this case, you know, a handful of elderly residents that do not pay any property taxes. And again, that's, this is different in the sense that it's not an exemption. They will pay eventually, and they will pay with a 4% interest instead of an 8% interest. When they move out of the house, when they choose, or when they pass away, their estate will pay it. And at that point going forward, if the estate is open for 2 years, it's going to be charged 12% a year for those 2 years. So in terms of dollars, again, it's not a big number, but this is not lost revenue. This is just deferred revenue.
If they sell the home,
mm-hmm. what? We have the first lien.
Okay, and the interest rate is that 4%?
Correct. I did check last night to make sure that if, for instance, they had a reverse mortgage, we do step in front of the bank. So we're the first lien holder.
When was the 8% set last time?
It's been like that, I think, forever. I think that was a state law that we never changed, and now we have an opportunity. But again, we had this opportunity before and didn't take it.
There's no way it can be like benchmarked to some.
No, the, well, 4 is the lowest allowed by state law. So I mean, you could say 5 or 7.
Should rates go up, we have to vote to change it from 4.
You'd have to change it. Yeah, you'd have to vote.
Okay. Can't make it to the prime rate or.
No.
Be nice, but. Okay.
Yeah.
I have a question I forgot to ask during our meeting, if you would
please,
oblige.
Please.
Would this also apply to water and sewer bills that are leaned
no.
to the property? Is that
oh,
a separate
that are leaned to the property.
Situation?
Yes, it would.
Oh, it would.
It would,
okay.
Yeah. Yeah, that's true. That does happen sometimes, and
yeah,
I bet these
we should probably include that in the discussion.
Yeah.
Not very often. But.
No, but yeah, it could.
Would this same interest rate apply? Is that what
yes.
you're suggesting as well?
Yep. Because at that point, when it's considered a property tax, where it's, when it's leaned to the property tax bill, it is a property tax.
So to make your water bill tax deductible.
Yes.
In a difficult way.
okay, so this isn't, it doesn't really have an impact at this point. So the tax bill is still deferred. The issue is
correct.
The interest rate that we're talking about.
And obviously, if it's not clear, the interest rate would change, as you see, on July 1st, 2017. So anything up till then is at 8.
And it's not retroactive, correct?
No, and if a person were to pass away in their house, then the interest rate is adjusted up to 12% as allowed by state law the next day.
Timing is everything.
Yeah.
Questions, comments? No? All right. Motion.
Motion to approve Article 6.
Have a second, please.
Second.
Peter, discussion? All right. We'll take a vote. Paul?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Vanessa?
Yes.
Mark? Yes. Ann?
Yes.
7-0. Mm-hmm. Okay. Let's go. Article 7.
A couple years ago, finance staff started looking for tools to protect seniors beyond those three you just saw. Actually, really, we only knew about two of them. We didn't know about the cost of living adjustment. Yeah, and obviously, those affect 20 people, and for the 20 people, it's very important. But there's a lot more seniors that we run into that have certain financial issues. And again, to be clear, we looked at this because we knew at some point there'd be a future override. We didn't look at this any other way at the time. We were quite surprised for the first year not to find any tool at all. There really was not any tool within state legislation, state tax policy that we could use. It wasn't until about last April when I was actually at a meeting in Wilmington and I heard about one of the models. It was
was the Sudbury model. Actually, Representative Jones was there, among others, and they were talking about it. And this is not something that was well known even in the assessing community, because there was one town, and now there's two towns that have that. So the only way for Reading to proceed was to do a home rule petition to have any kind of tax protection for seniors. We studied the two models that were in existence. I talked to other town managers. Our assessor talked to to other assessors, but also probably a little more importantly to the state DOR. To be approved, this first requires a positive vote at town meeting. And I don't mean to minimize that, but in tax policy, going to the state and changing tax policy is a high hurdle. So that's why talking to the DOR especially was very important. Our legislators, you know, were clued in early on this, and they said, make sure you talk to the DOR, because this is not a layoff. So what we have proposed has been run by the DOR for quite some time. I won't say they like it, because they would never give that opinion. But they said it would be fine. And they suggested, and some of the town managers suggested, there's a lot of interest in this in the Commonwealth. This is a problem that's hit most communities, and that you know, it may or may not become a model for other towns, you know, who knows. There's some questions sent by Eric that I'll also kind of weave into the answers for this. The first one was, it looks like there's only an income test in this, and that's correct. There's not an asset test, but there is under the charge of the Board of Assessors generically, they always have the ability under any tax deferral, any tax exemption, or any tax relief program to look at assets. That's their right by state law. So that not only applies to this, but all the other things we discussed. And it's purely a discretionary call, and it's one that is not used very often by boards of assessors. But if for some reason a person had $35,000 of annual income and $10 million of assets, then I'm quite sure they would be denied under this program. Most people that have assets produce income with it, though, so again, it's not frequent. So that's kind of a small footnote, but it is important to know that it is there. Let's see. Okay, I'll answer that one next. In looking at the two towns that used it, again, Wayland and Sudbury, one of the towns actually just forgave property tax. They did not collect it. So they had a dollar figure that worked out. And by the way, none of them had any idea what would happen when they implemented this. They really had no idea. They just took guesses. And that's from their assessors. So one of them just decided to waive the income. And the other one said, no, we're going to need that. So they reassigned it to other residential. There was no question in Reading we were not going to just waive income. You know, we're looking for every bit of revenue we can. So, you know, that was a clear choice from one of the models. When we first reviewed it with the selectmen, I'm going to say maybe 2 months ago, I don't remember exactly, the first thing Dan would have seen is a $7,200 average property tax bill, and the maximum tax relief would have been 50% of that, $3,600, for not a lot of seniors, but the ones that would qualify. And the test at the time was very much a very graduated benefit. So there would have been, I guess I'll say, quote unquote, a lot of seniors that would qualify, very few for $3,600, some for $15, and then a whole bunch of bell curve in between, basically, we guess. We don't really know that. I made a comment that benefit seemed too high, and that's just if we're trying to protect people from an override that might cost $500 or $1,000, $3,600 was not the objective. So we thought, well, we're going to have to change that. And then in looking, again, at the two pieces side by side, and especially talking to DOR, Victor, our assessor, came up with the circuit breaker as the best formula. And, you know, the circuit breaker is a state-set program. It is state-set benchmarks. And so one would think, and quietly there was a nod that we could notice, that they liked that idea. You know, if you're going to use our program, there's not a lot of discretion there. That's good. But then the question was the state circuit breaker current benefit maximum is, I think it's $1,070. So how many people are going to qualify? The next thing the selectmen did broadly was discuss what's the most amount of relief they would move around within the tax base.
We had discussed as high as $1.5 million, and the selectmen said, please keep it under $1 million. So again, although the knowledge we have is not perfect, what we do know is 640-odd people in 2014 in Reading qualified for the circuit breaker. The home rule petition sets the benefit, if you will, the exemption between 50% and 200% of that CB income tax benefit. So if it was set at a given year at 200%, 200% times 1,070 is, you know, just over $2,000. So if 640 people times $2,000 qualified, that's more than $1 million. On the low side, I guess I'll say 50% of that, you'd be looking at $500,000-$600,000 if everyone qualified. Who are the people that are in that 600 pool that won't qualify, and who's not in the pool that might join the pool? Renters are not in that pool for property tax relief. They are for income tax relief. It's one of the qualifications in Reading, or in this one, is that you have owned property for the last 10 consecutive years in Reading. So this is not meant to be a benefit that someone will move to town in order to get. It's to protect people who've been here for a long time. The selectmen discussed even a longer period of time, and the assessors greatly discouraged them from that, because under all kinds of state law, 10 years is the most that he had ever seen, and I would agree with that. You know, initially we had thought as long as 20 years. So the 640, the way that one of the other towns that use that approach, for what it's worth, is it cut their pool in half. So their pool is much smaller than ours, but if 640 was the first pool, then 320 people are left standing by this renter test. But, you know, to be fair, we don't know how many people may not even file a state income tax because their income is so low. They don't even have to.
Except they still get the circuit breaker if they do.
But they may not even be paying a tax because it's so low. So that,
but it's a refundable tax.
It is, but my understanding is if you have low enough income, you'd have to pay an income, and then you'd get it rebated, so why bother to file? I don't know.
Well,
okay.
It's not refundable?
I have filed the last several years and have not paid any state tax, but I have got
okay.
Okay.
That's a little different than I heard, but... Okay. So maybe there won't be any people or many people that'll suddenly file, but I did actually hear from one person that said, for this I might file, so I don't know what that means anymore. Maybe it means it wasn't worth the, and again, it's a graduated.
Understanding, so some people.
Well, it's a graduated income benefit, so maybe the benefit was very low. The other thing we know in Reading is the average benefit was in the $800 range, 800 and something. The maximum's 1,000, so some people are getting much less. And again, the data from the state, those are the only two things we know. Well, we know how many people, and we know the average, and that's all we know. So the reason the selectmen decided to pick what is a rather broad band of 50% to 200% is because we don't know. The selectmen also indicated, if you go to your warrant reports, I think it's on page 8. Yes.
You want to point out the correction?
I will, yeah.
Good.
On the top of page 8, if you will, the midpoint of 50 and 200% or 125%, as I'll say, the target. That would be, by coincidence, $1,070 for that average person in Reading that qualified in 2014. So $1,000 is kind of the mental target. And again, it, you know, who knows how many people will qualify, but if the whole pool qualified at that average, that's an income tax refund of $550,000. So again, you do the math down as shown down below, or right above, rather.
Bob, it's those who qualify and apply, correct?
And that's the other point is you don't have to apply.
No.
Well, if you don't want to qualify, you don't
right.
have to apply. If
you
want
to
qualify, you do. But this is all public record, and if you will, much more visible and much more available than state income tax data is, which is also public record. But you can't go online and look up someone's state income taxes. You will be able to go online in Reading and look up who got this benefit, just to be clear. So I don't know if that influences anyone, but just to put it out there.
And you do have to be a senior to file for that Schedule CD?
Yeah, if you look down at the bottom of 8, the qualifications are, I'll just read them.
Yep.
You or your spouse, if married, filing jointly must be at least 65 years of age on or before January 1st. You must file as single, married, filing jointly, or head of household. The asset value of your principal residence must be $691,000 or less. Qualifying income, and I'm going to come back to that, is capped at $56,000 for single, all the way up to $84,000 for married filing jointly. I know we've had some public meetings where that number struck some people as high, and I can't really comment on that, but it's really important to know that the qualifying income is not your mass adjusted gross income. You add back a lot of things and you take away some tax exemptions from that figure in order to get to the number they're looking at. So just to be clear, it's not the same as mass AGI. And then probably most importantly, the real estate taxes that you pay in a year plus 50% of your water and sewer bill, and it is the whole bill, it's not just debt, must be 10% or more of that qualified income figure that you've hit above. So again, its purpose is to find out who is paying as a percent of their income the most property tax. And when the selectmen discussed this a couple of years ago, there were all kinds of indirect ways to get at that, theoretically, and Dan came up with some of them. And it would have been pretty accurate, but this is precise. This is exactly the target audience that the selectmen had in mind is, are we pricing some people out of this town because of property taxes compared to their income? And that's exactly what this does.
By the way, if you get that deduction 1 year, it's counted against the next year as an income.
It's like a state tax refund.
Yeah.
If you
say you have to add it back in. So that's a good one to add here.
So that's kind of the benefit side, as best as I can describe it. Who pays? And this will get into one of Eric's questions.
Well, not only, just to go back to that point, if you qualify for our exemption, then your taxes are going to be lower, and you might not qualify for the state.
That's correct.
Yeah.
So you qualify and then unqualify, but that's the next year.
you wouldn't get your money back from the state that because you didn't pay the taxes.
Well, just to be clear, the local one is always looking back a year, not in the current year. So it's always looking at what did the state approve you, not will the state approve you for the next year or the current year. Just to wrap that up, you file taxes generally in April. This takes effect by applying to the Board of Assessors in August, maybe July, but certainly by August. And that's, again, based on your tax return ending the prior December. So that's a good 6-7 months later. People will have got their mass income taxes back. They can then show, I qualified. The Board of Assessors and the assessor will look at it and go through all the qualifications and then present the selectmen. Here's a list. 232 people. Here's the details. Just to be real clear, in the first year, if it were to pass, obviously this tax change cannot happen with the first two tax bills, which are set in July and then in the fall. So the first year, the benefit is all lumped into the last two out of the four tax bills, and after that it's smoothed out, just so everyone's clear on that. But it is something that'll be brought to the selectmen usually in November as part of their tax rate setting, which I'm going to come back to. On page 8, there was an unfortunate typo that single family homes of $700,000 were paying the least and $300,000 were paying the most. It's not really true. It's meant to be $300,000 down to $700,000 on the chart, just like commercial property. So this is the cost. And the selectmen have had a discussion, and to answer one of Eric's questions, the home rule petition, as is required by state law, moves the money around inside only the residential class. And that's the only option you have under state tax law. Completely separately, the selectmen then set a factor. And in the factor setting process, which in Reading right now is uniform at 1.0, they can then shift some portion of this cost to the other taxpayers, commercial, industrial, personal property. And the round number for right now, theoretically, was a 1.02 factor would make the tax rate about equal for residential and commercial. If you did not shift any to commercial, the tax rate on residential would be higher than on commercial. And the rest of the residential payers would pay the whole up to $1 million of
tax relief.
Just to add to that, Bob, this would not presumably take place until FY '18, if the earliest, the same year as the override would, if it passes, be in effect. So this would not be the classification vote this December or November that we take, it'd be the following December. But the board did indicate, of course, we can't bind a future board of selectmen, but the indication would be to go to a factor of 1.02 in FY '18, in that subsequent December vote, to equalize. It would then be the same tax rate for both classes. But what would happen is, when you shift all this around in the residential, because you're losing some revenue, you have to raise the tax rate to compensate within that class. So that would, if we kept the same factor of one, commercial would have a lower rate than residential. So we're setting 1.02 just to equalize the two tax rates by virtue of having done that. Does that make sense?
Yeah, the only question is, so what town meeting is gonna vote on, because we can't bind that
you
commercial
can, right.
rate.
Right.
It means it's all, we have to view it as all residential with a comment on the side saying
right.
that, but the goal is to.
There's a future intent, but
right.
intents are intents.
Right.
Yeah, and just to follow that, if it were $1 million, you know, which again is the maximum, we're talking about $80,000 being moved on to businesses.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Bob, can you help me with the timing again a little bit? It would be for FY 18, mm-hmm. which you mentioned about. I didn't quite follow you. The two tax bills are already set.
Let me also just discuss the override in that sense.
Okay.
If we did nothing else and an override is passed and this is passed, what would happen under current state law is that the override would be effective for all of FY 18, but you would only be charged for it in the last half of the year. So if you had an $800 increase, you'd see the same tax bill in the first quarter, the same one in the second quarter, and then you'd really be whacked in the
yeah.
third and fourth quarter, and you pay a whole year's worth, and then it would go down after that.
Same thing here on.
And the same thing with this.
Yeah,
if there's a benefit,
yeah.
the benefit is much larger in the second half.
Well, and
we
also
can,
for the other residents bearing the cost of that benefit.
Yes.
Yeah.
We can actually change the impact of the override by doing estimated tax bills, so it smooths out that, which
oh,
is good.
Good.
But we can't do an estimated bill for this senior tax relief.
Right.
That'll just have to be in the first year a bit bumpy. But again, just to put some numbers on it, at the target of the selectmen, we discussed the maximum million, average single family house, $115, which is right. But at the target, that's $81, you know, for the typical house. And businesses, you can see we discussed $90 and $200 for 70% of the properties. Or 60 and 140 at this target benefit. You know, there's no need in kind of getting into semantics of all that. The numbers just kind of lay out there and they are what they are.
Bob, just on the, I think there's another correction you need to make on that chart. The under the max relief residential, the second number down.
Oh, yeah.
I think it's 92,
oh, yeah, yeah, yeah.
not 192.
You're right.
Otherwise,
oh, boy.
I want to get reassessed quick.
Yeah, we had someone in mind, I'm sure. It's hard to proofread when your eyes are going in circles.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad you saw that.
Stop dreaming.
Yeah, right. If you'd stop making me.
The advantage here is the relief to the elderly, the qualified. The disadvantage is you are shifting the burden to other classes of taxpayers to pay
yeah.
for that relief.
Right.
And the reason for the timing, if it isn't clear, is if you waited for this, an override would hit first. You know, if you waited to see, it said, let's do this one in April,
yeah.
or let's even do this one in November. We could not be sure. If we wanted to wait till the override is voted and then bring this in November, we have no guarantee whatsoever that this home rule petition will get through the state in time to be effective July 1st. We do have that guarantee in September. That was an important factor. And honestly, that's the reason why the September town meeting was called, is just for this single article. The others could have happened at other times.
Bob, what happens if, playing these out, this goes through and takes effect,
mm-hmm.
but the override doesn't pass?
Mm-hmm.
It remains in effect.
Stands on its
yep.
own merits.
Yeah.
The board has discretion about
Ah, that's okay, that's the loop, that's the connection I was.
Well, do we have?
It's in place and the board has discretion.
It's in place, you only have discretion between the 50% and 200%.
Well, we have to enact it at some level.
It is enacted and you could just say 50% if you wished.
This also is 3 years of program.
That's another good point, and that can be amended at town meeting, but not up. The state will not approve longer than 3 years.
That's another disadvantage. We have indications from Representative Jones and others that the state is considering this on a statewide basis.
It is such a common problem that,
right.
You know, I'll say being considered, I don't know how much that really means, but.
So if they put similar measures into place when this expires, there'll be no gap. However, another disadvantage is if this goes away and there's nothing to replace it in the way of another home rule, all that relief goes away for the seniors.
Yeah, and I know from some public meetings we had and some feedback we had, there was definitely some, I don't know, agitation about those income levels that the state is using. A home rule petition can do whatever you want it to do. The state is not going to get in the way if we change those income levels. However, we don't have any data, so that's just an emotional reaction right now to what someone thinks should happen or what might happen. If we let this program run for 2 or 3 years, we'll have actual real data, and then we can make a much more informed decision. And on top of that, and probably most importantly, we're going to be spending $60,000 or $70,000 to hire someone if we change the state model, because we don't have the staffing to go through what could be thousands of applications in the first year. And just to remind you, it is all confidential data, so it's not we can sort of hire a temp firm to do this. I mean, this has to be a real employee. So we just thought it was very simple, and I was a little surprised that the assessors are willing to take this on with no extra staffing, but they would. They said this, that, you know, given form C, schedule CB, it wouldn't be a big burden. They can handle that with current staffing. And just to remind you, we have a half-time chief assessor we share with Wakefield.
So my question was, they could have 600 or more applications, and they're saying they can handle
it. They expect 1,000 in the first year, and they can handle that. They'll probably start in July instead of waiting till August to be done by September. And obviously, we would need to put out all kinds of communication. Our assessor is going to have lunch next week at the senior center as an example, just to talk about all this with whoever wants to come.
Is there any verification process of what's on the CB?
That's up to the state. If as long as the state has said yes and you've qualified and you've seen the tax return, we do know from the state what they've allowed or what they've said yes to.
Okay.
So, you know, if we don't do any verification of income, but they would. We have the opportunity to ask.
Yeah, right. That's, we assume everyone's honest about their taxes, right?
We assume that, yes.
Of course they are.
What have you heard from other towns, if anything?
The two towns that passed it were quite surprised at how completely variable the results were. They were not what they would have guessed. They were generally lower, less people qualified than they expected because of the rental piece. I don't know enough about Wayland and Sudbury to really analyze it, but I would not have thought there was a high rental base there, but yet half of them dropped away. I assume that was condo or apartment or something. Otherwise, people were now just where we were 2 years ago, starting to scratch their heads and thinking about it and thinking, you know, two levels, and I've said this in public, and I know Dan was surprised the first time, but I'll say it again. Socially, it's the right thing to do to keep elders in their house, or at least not force them out because of the property tax. There's all kinds of reasons someone's going to have to move. We don't want that to be it. They're also cheaper than this, giving this poor fellow more students.
Yes.
So, you know, it's enlightened self-interest, as they say.
Aging in place. Name of the game.
Aging in place. And a lot of our planning efforts for the last few years have been designed at this. This is the largest growing section of demographic in every town, is the over 55, actually. You know, we're trying to bring some of that downtown, in the downtown area, some of the senior housing. So there's a lot of reasons. What you really want is a good mix in your community, not any one or the other.
So the number decreased due to renters and then also the 10-year threshold.
Yes, absolutely. And again, that was the objective from the start, was someone that came in many years ago and bought their house
and is quite satisfied today with the services they get and the taxes they pay is a tough situation. All of a sudden, we might ask for more one day. They're going to have to move. I've talked to two different seniors 2 years ago that said I would absolutely have to sell my house. If you go up $1,000, I cannot afford that. It's not a question of I don't like it, I can't. You know, and I take them at their word. Those would be the people that clearly would benefit if that's an accurate statement. You know, they'll benefit from this. And we won't force them to make that choice just on this reason.
So I attended, I think, at least two of the meetings with the selectmen regarding this, and it was clearly the intent of the town, I think, and the selectmen to bring forward this kind of a proposal. So my view was in thinking about it as, is it a reasonable approach? Is it something that has reasonable controls around it? Is it something people can understand? And in fact, the other thing that I thought was appropriate was to consider the commercial taxpayers as well, and to see if there may be a way to have them participate. And although that part isn't binding, it's under consideration. So I think as my view on this was, you know, hey, is this a reasonable approach? Is using the circuit breaker a reasonable way to do it? Wanted to make sure that we weren't saving, you know, one person that was going to be going through all the applications and losing, on the other hand, you know, a ton of money. You know, are we going to lose $500,000 of people who kind of are taking advantage of the system? Versus, you know, just hiring another person. It would seem straightforward. Hey, we hire another person instead of letting that happen. And I heard the discussions from a number of residents saying, hey, $84,000 is a pretty big number. And I'm kind of giving you my thinking through it. The discussion.
The other thing is at the $84,000 level, you're going to qualify for less.
Right. Yeah. It graduates down.
Also, the higher value homes qualify for less.
Yes. Yeah. Right. Yeah.
The gentleman called me about that tonight. He's Dan, $691,000, and they're getting benefits from this, but it's...
Yeah, you're on the small end of the curve.
And very, very small.
And the other point is your tax bill has to be, plus water and sewer, has to be more than 10% of your income. So if you are earning $80,000, you have to have an $8,000 tax bill.
The water and sewer part, is that doesn't apply in every town. There's certain towns that it does, and we're one of the towns that it does.
I understood it to first mean only if you had put debt.
Well,
but yeah, I'm told it's all town. Well, the circuit breaker is all towns that charge water.
Yeah. No, if.
Yes, you can. In writing, you can take 50%
of it. I don't qualify, so I never pay attention to that. But I know that there are certain towns that are listed, and if you're in listed towns, you can include your water and sewer. If you're not in listed towns, then you can't.
Do you have any idea why there's that list?
I do not. It didn't apply to the person whose return I was doing.
Yes, I think those are the towns that have the same as Winchester bond. They're paying it on the interest on the tax rate on the bonds, is it?
Winchester's one of the few that shifted debt on the tax.
Yeah, and I think that's what he's referring to.
No, because Reading has not done that.
No.
Only Winchester has done that.
Let's say the DOR hasn't come back on me yet, so.
Okay.
If they do, I'll do whatever.
Just to be clear, when we bought into the MWRA, for instance, you know, obviously we're taking on a lot of debt in the water fund. The selectmen at the time considered, should we take this debt instead and put it on the tax levy? As excluded debt on top of the tax levy, sorry. And that would have required a vote of the residents. But probably more importantly, when we visited Winchester a couple times, and there's no way you can equalize what a taxpayer's home or business is worth versus how much water they use. You know, think of an extreme Winchester hospital.
Yeah.
The car wash. The typical home, maybe it's not so bad, but you're basically shifting money out of a heavy water user onto a property tax, and the two things are very unlike. So Winchester, in order to do it, has three different water rates based on use, so they could hit the hospital with the highest one. So we just decided to leave it in the water fund, but that way it would have made it deductible on federal income taxes if you paid the water debt, let's say, as part of your property tax. And in Winchester, they estimated in the first year that their residents saved $400,000 or $500,000 of federal income tax. That's why they did it. That was a number of years ago. My understanding is that it absolutely is correct in Reading. I don't know
how the list was put together you talked about, Peter.
Actually, see if I can figure that out.
Yeah.
Dan, did you say that the, did I hear you right? You said the higher value homes would qualify for
up to $691, is it?
Yeah.
But.
Principal.
Yeah, if you look at that table on page 8, you'll see that.
This is point number 2, the very bottom of page.
If you get the numbers in the right direction, yeah.
Right. So 10% of the homes won't qualify, more or less.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Oh, wait a minute.
I misheard you, I thought you said that the.
That's the burden that's paid, I'm sorry.
Well, if you have a house that's assessed at more than $691, no matter what your income is, you don't qualify.
Right, yeah.
And that's about 10% of our single family.
We might want a table showing that too, and a handout for town meeting, showing how the benefit declines with increasing housing value. Is there a way to do that?
I've tried to do that and I couldn't figure it out.
Hard to do it?
Yeah. I'll show you what I sent you what I did.
How is it declining with their increasing?
Exactly, you needed 4 dimensions.
Right. Increasing housing.
Well, maybe just picking a couple of points.
You either do or you don't.
This income and this.
Above or below 600.
I know that anecdotally, I haven't seen the pro before. Yeah, so I get the wrong table, what I just said.
So kind of closing where I was before, my take on it personally is that this seems like a very reasonable approach to accomplish the goals that are being set out, and it provides the right information for town meeting to assess what they want to do about it. So that's my personal opinion.
One of your criteria was easily understood.
As easily as possible. I wouldn't say it's easy.
And I think this is within reach of comprehension. I do remember people got hung up on the income level, and so driving that point home, it's you qualify for less as your income goes up.
Right.
Yeah, I think that's helpful.
Right. And I would imagine too that a great thing that we might be able to do is to find some volunteers to go to the senior center and help people understand this even better. Folks who are
well,
Victor's doing
sure.
A
yeah.
Lunch next week, I think.
Yeah.
We'll be over there every week if it passes.
The form's in half.
Yeah.
Other questions or comments?
None. I mean, more just a comment similar to what you were saying. I think, you know, it's helpful that it's, yeah, I would agree. It's certainly not simple, but with hopefully a couple slides in in discussion at town meeting, we can show directionally here's how the benefit moves as, you know, these criteria are adjusted up and down without going into, you know, the finest level of detail, because I think that's might be where we get hung up. But I think it appears to me that it's in line with the discussions that generally have taken place over the last year, the spirit of what we've been hearing. So I think I look at it as more as, can we see it, can we understand it, and do we see any flaws in it, which I don't, and then it's obviously up to town meeting from that point.
Given that this does not change the amount of taxes, can you people take a vote on this? I think that question came up last meeting when I'm sitting in my pajamas.
So
I didn't know.
Yeah, I think the answer is yes. I did some homework looking at the Division of Local Services, a guide to financial management for town officials, and their definition about the role of the Finance Committee.
Mm-hmm.
I'm happy to share this with you, but let me just read it for a second. The Finance Committee is the official fiscal watchdog for a town. Because it's difficult for all taxpayers to be completely informed about every aspect of a town's finances, Finance Committees were established so a representative group of taxpayers could conduct a thorough review of municipal finance questions on behalf of all citizens. It goes a lot further. It then lays out, says, if you want more information, look at the Finance Committee Handbook.
Yep.
And Finance Committee Handbook has an interesting quotation. Quote, it is generally agreed that finance committees may consider any matter they feel will have a fiscal impact on the town, comma, as well as any other matters the committee feels are relevant. It may reasonably be argued that little comes before town meeting that does not have a potential fiscal impact on the town.
But does the handbook override the town bylaws?
Actually, it goes in coordination with the town bylaws, because I believe finance committees are set up with certain powers, and then the bylaws go with it.
If I read section 3.2.
I can simply answer, town council said he's right.
Okay.
I did check.
Feels kind of like Indiana Jones, you know, with the pipe going.
I had to ask.
That's why I asked.
And I did the homework as well, trying to understand what that was.
I would just like to give major kudos to Bob, Victor Santiel, our assessor, and Chairman Halsey, who have worked tirelessly on this for the better part of the last year.
Yeah, I think they've done a very nice job putting it together in a digestible form. And again, I think the intent has been clear. And I think our role is to kind of be able to give that information to town meeting.
I think the most difficult part is the width of the 50 to 200%, and that's just because there's just no good data, there's no sense of certainty at all. I don't often speak for the board, but I think the current board, 3 years from now, if they were still sitting there, would be very amenable to narrowing that, because they would have a much better idea of what had happened. Because the goal is not to give somewhere between $250 and $1 million of tax relief. They know what their goal is, they just don't know what the applicants will look like.
When will they determine what the tax relief will be between that range? Will they determine what the tax relief will be?
Usually in November, sometimes October, they have a tax classification hearing, so they would do it then, and that's effective the following July 1st. That's when they also set the factor between commercial and residential.
This is a statutory part of that vote.
Yes.
Now, yeah.
Right.
If we adopt this.
And that's at a fully advertised public hearing. It's usually a full one.
I looked at the CB, and that per town thing isn't there anymore. So, not from a few years ago.
Okay, that's interesting.
Ann, do you have any comments?
No comments. I think, other than to say, I think that folks have done a really nice job of putting this package together.
Ann, do you have any insights from our representative as to where this might be heading in the state?
I've had a conversation with Senator Lewis in which he had mentioned that he'd be willing to put us in touch with officials from the town of Winchester about their experience. They ended up attempting something or considering something like this and then abandoning it. He had indicated that folks from Winchester would be willing to discuss their experience with us.
Any indication of whether there's movement on a statewide adoption, or is it premature?
That I don't know. Okay. It is, the legislature is meeting in informal sessions at this time, and home rule petitions often do go through in informal sessions.
Right.
But with regard to this petition in particular, I'm not sure.
Thanks.
Any other questions or comments? No? We should entertain a motion.
Motion to approve Article 7.
Can I have a second?
Second.
Thank you, Vanessa. Any other discussion? No hearing. Paul?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
David?
Yes.
Vanessa?
Yes.
Mark? Yes. Ann?
Yes.
All right, we are 7. 0-0. Okay, Article 8. Okay, how to attack this?
I don't have any idea how to help you on that.
That's the $1 million question.
So again, I think.
Yeah,
exactly right. So, I mean, I think that the analysis that's in here, the description, kind of goes through quite nicely what the background looks like. At our last meeting, we went through some of the assumptions that were baked into the model in terms of, state aid activities.
And I did change 7.5% health insurance, 2.5% state aid. It added up to virtually nothing, as we thought.
Right.
And I know you're more comfortable with that.
Right, just based on some historical state aid sorts
of
questions. We'd love more. So, has everyone had a chance to kind of either participate in that meeting or watch it on TV? I know we had a quorum at the meeting, which is great. I mean, from my perspective, the modeling that kind of accompanies the assumptions here seem to make sense, and we went through them last time. It seems very clear, and we've discussed at the last three town meetings, I think, that the FinCom presentation has highlighted, as have some of the other presentations, that we were coming toward the precipice, and we are there. And the issue now, I think, is, you know, what is that kind of structural issue? I think this is a very planned and very good approach to looking at and see what it's going to look like going forward. And it makes sense to me in terms of how it's being viewed. The discussion that ensued about, well, what about things that we have lost and things that are still needed and that are important as community priorities? I think the selectmen addressed that. And you know, they selected a number, which is their prerogative to do that. And I think the information is, you know, laid out as best as it can, and the challenge starts to become how to get as many people as possible involved in the discussion at this point, with meetings like tomorrow night and beyond that, right up to the election. So that's kind of my take on where we are. Want to take it, Paul?
Sure. I'm not sure I have much else to say, though. I certainly agree with, you know, with those statements that, yeah, the biggest part is continuing the discussion. Tomorrow will be an important night from our end, hopefully. Hopefully high turnout and lots of questions to be asked tomorrow night. But, you know, the nice thing is the way the material was presented and pulled together for us really led to no surprises. It's how everything has moved logically along, you know, based on the conversations we've had for the last several meetings. So, you know, hopefully folks are watching and paying attention to those, and we get the turnout tomorrow night.
Other comments?
Bob, can you talk about what Alan wants to do in terms of the progression of this article, how he wants to structure the discussion?
Alan and John Halsey and I met extensively earlier in the week, and he's going to make an announcement after Article 7 as to how he intends to proceed, but we didn't want to say anything before.
Okay. The board is also being called to order that night, Board of Selectmen?
Yeah, the board will be in order. I assume the school committee and the trustees will have quorums. And just for a reference, the selectmen will not have a quorum tomorrow night, so they will not be in session. I don't know if the school committee
will. Are we running afoul of the directive to not meet during town meeting? Is that a hard guide?
No, you're always posted. As is FinCom.
Is there some stipulation we can't meet during town meeting, Bill?
Yes, you adjourn 5 minutes before.
That's true.
Well, we could recess the meeting, I guess. Yeah. The town meeting happened, pick it up after.
Yeah.
Okay.
I know the bylaws.
No, I don't.
Turn around. You know, town council's right.
You were here before there were any bylaws.
Yes.
In the beginning was Bill Brown.
1943.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So what we should talk about also then is there are going to be presentations. There are reports to be delivered as part of Article 8. FinCom is one of those reports, which I think is appropriate. I think it's appropriate for us to have an indication for town meeting about what this looks like, why, the process, if there's other information that we want to bring to it regarding either Prop 2.5 in general or specific to this. I don't know whether or not it's a vote that we take or it's just a presentation that's
no
made.
Votes.
Yeah, no votes.
Okay.
Inappropriate.
Okay. So then the presentation that goes through is something we probably should talk a little bit about, maybe even have a little subcommittee to review. And I'm happy to kind of captain what the presentation that I'll be making will be. but would appreciate the ability to kind of share that when we pick a subcommittee to work on that. Before we do that, we have representative towns and schools. Is there any things that you guys wanted to share and select, excuse me?
Yeah,
share with us?
Spoken enough. I'll do.
School side?
The other thing I want to add, and Gene wants to go into more detail, the school committee did meet Monday night and vote on a reprioritized list based on the vote that was taken by the Board of Selectmen, totaling $2.96 million.
Which is?
So that list will be part of my presentation tomorrow night.
Great. And do we have tomorrow night's format? How?
You're gonna start, what do you wanna do tomorrow night?
How are we gonna do this?
We do things informally. In general, I have to stand up and give some kind of an overview introduction. It's really hard to know the audience for these. The three listening sessions, I'd say there was two that were similar and one that was very different. It's really hard to know what to do, and it's, town meeting's gonna be the same. I mean, I know what we've shown town meeting in the past, so I have an idea of their background. So I have a little better idea, but, you know, should we go over all the peer community stuff? I put it in the report. I don't feel obliged to talk to town meeting about it, or tomorrow night. We've already done that. So tomorrow night, I haven't timed it. I've only sent John the draft. Is, I'll say, 15-minute, 20-minute overview of what's going on. And then at the end, we'll each have 10 minutes or so to talk about the additions. And we don't really want to talk about the subtractions, but we'll have to say something about the subtractions as well. And that's the part that's, I know, the most sensitive. And people want to know, and I understand that. But I don't want people that know to be employees, you know, for an obvious reason. And honestly, as I sit here, I don't know the answer. I know some of the answer. Just to let you know, this will be in the selectman's packet, the chair knows. I put a hiring freeze on some time ago, and any vacant position needs my permission to be filled. And I have given limited permission for vacant positions. I've allowed police to fill some of their vacancies or expected vacancies for retirements, and no one else. So that's just preparing us, you know, through attrition as best we can. And attrition alone will not balance the town's budget. A year ago, we had 25 vacant positions, a lot of them, some of them part-time. Right now, the number's less than 10. So, you know, less than 10 will not balance the budget without an override. And part of that discussion is really FinCom's. If we go into a November financial forum after town meeting, let's say, I have no sense, and you probably don't yet either, is how much free cash will you use to balance an FY18 budget after a failed override? You know, you used two odd million last year. The figure's 3 million now. I think we can all agree that's off the table. Is 2 million even on the table anymore? I don't know. So that's why it's difficult for John or I to really answer. We can answer if zero free cash is used, then it's 30 roughly FTEs and let's say 10 on the town, because we have more expenses than John does versus wages. But what are you willing to do?
Yeah, I think, so speak for me, let's have a discussion. I think the reality is that we've learned a little bit in terms of regeneration. We've changed some of the assumptions that we've built into things. And in the past, although we've used 2 million, it hasn't appeared that way because the regeneration was so high. So the net use has been negative, actually. Right? Mm-hmm. It's actually been
in some years
cash.
It's been negative. Yeah.
Yeah.
Actually, in more years than more.
Yeah.
Than
especially
that.
Recently. So it looks like free cash has been building. So, you know, the reality of that is yes, we used free cash, but we regenerated so much that it's gone higher. And I think that with assumptions changed, the likelihood of those high regenerations, we've kind of factored it in already.
Right.
I wouldn't want to factor it in twice.
Yeah. Speaking for Sharon, at least as the town accountant, she's not totally comfortable, but pretty comfortable with a million as regeneration still. 750, yes, a million, oh, maybe okay. So a million use of free cash is perhaps a neutral statement, but no more than that at this point.
And we have some, you know, wide open things that we can't. We don't know what they'll be. We don't know how TLT plays out, what that impact might be.
Yep.
We also know that our peer communities are also carrying high free cash balances. In fact, we talked to the auditors about that. And that's kind of where things are right now. We just amended our policy tonight towards 7%, which is higher than where it was before, just kind of understanding that there could be some vagaries and things that could happen. So my personal opinion is I $3 million certainly off the table from my perspective. I don't think $2 million is on the table.
I would agree.
I think it's probably, you know, it's one or less kind of thing in just thinking about it offhand, my opinion. But
yeah, no, I think you had a great point when you started that, I'll say, revisions and changes in some of the estimates and assumptions as we look at regeneration and what does that regeneration really mean. We have to reach the bottom point where now open positions are less than 10.
I can probably get
there. I can't remember which ones, but buried in those years where we had larger regeneration, some of that was from open positions. So there's one piece that's going away, change in estimates that are probably more accurate and more in line with trends, not that the old ones weren't, but we revised moving forward. So I know I say it every time, but sooner or later it's going to stop. It's,
yeah.
There can only be so many unique one-time hits that keep coming in. So, I mean, I know it took a lot to get to a $2 million number, and that is certainly not a sustainable place to be.
In your presentation tomorrow night, keep it simple.
Yeah.
I passed along to
Dan. I got those, yeah. Thanks.
The chat. If you go through that, was it 10 pages of all that gobbledygook? And
what are you talking about? I think you'd like to see this one with dollar figures.
Yeah.
Effectively.
Yeah,
yeah, I got that in the presentation.
Yeah.
Which sure, it's simple.
And
without an override, what's the next 10 years tax bill look like with a $7.5 million override? What are the 10-year tax bill look like?
By piece.
Course. And line it up with the declining, so the people can say what their total tax bill is.
Yeah.
Because I, like many others, assumed that it was only $7,250. So when I got your book,
it's a little less.
It can be confusing.
Less, okay.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people are confused with that.
Right.
So what I did with Dan, I sent along to Dan, was put what comes out on what is a tax levy,
right.
And then
the library and high school,
the exemptions, exclusions,
right.
And then what's my total tax bill,
right.
And
yes.
That's what people want to know.
Yes.
And over time, is what people want.
Yeah.
For each.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think we actually talked about that. I think that makes very good sense.
I certainly agree with keeping it simple. I wonder if building up the story might be helpful in some way. My sense currently is that there'll be some people there tomorrow night who weren't at the listening session.
Yeah.
So
yes, of course. Yeah.
I would say a sizable amount
right.
that are just hearing this for the first time. And so, you know, what is an override?
Folks are just starting to pay attention. It's like
yeah.
general
yeah.
political
yeah.
season.
Yeah.
And
I think that the why needs to kind of be the starting point. Why are we here? Are we? Why are we here? And then what are we talking about? And what's the exact impact that I'd be?
Yeah, to me, what's my cost?
Right. Chief.
The benefit of where we're at now versus where we were at with the community listening sessions is we actually know we have two binary choices now. That was not true with
right.
the listening
right.
sessions. It was a much broader moment
yeah.
of this
right.
and moment of this. Now there's two things are going to happen on October 19th. That we're going to be in two very different places. So certainly from a school committee perspective, and Dr. Doherty and I are already discussing this, option A is this particular override that was passed by the Board of Selectmen does not pass. Everyone's tax bills continue to go up to 2.5% a year. That looks like this.
Mm-hmm.
Here's the outcome on the town side. So I'll
right.
certainly be looking to the municipal side to explain what that impact is over the next several years. And to your point, Bob, John and I have already been talking about the necessity to be very careful in how we communicate that, but I do think people need to understand the scope of what that's going to look like. So very broad stroke, and it's threading the needle, right? Not
yeah.
creating a panic or a problem or a morale problem, but also being transparent with voters about you don't want anyone coming back saying, well, you didn't say it was going to be like this. So we're working on that balance. But I do think we have an obligation to communicate that. This, if this is a no, this is the scope, not the details, not exactly what and where, but this is the scope of the kind of cuts you're going to see and the impact on the school side to student achievement. If it's a yes, I think your point is exactly right. Here's what the cost is.
Yeah.
You individually, you need to understand that. And here's what, again, only speaking from the schools, this is what the schools are going to look like for the next 5 to 10 years. And here's what we can provide with that. So I don't know if that's helpful, but when I, anytime I think about presenting between now and October 18th, that's what I'm thinking. It's two presentations. No means this. There's the cost. Yes means this. That's the cost. That's the choice.
Sorry. I think that's extremely helpful because I know you and I are sitting together at one of the meetings, and I've been in all these meetings, and still, when the number came out of, you know, what we were talking about from number of positions potentially lost, if
yep.
no was the answer, I was shocked.
Yep.
And I've sat in a lot more of these than
and
the average. No, please go ahead.
And the trick is to describe scope, because the number right now that's getting a headline is 30. Well, that number was arrived at taking a $2 million cut, which is based on projections, which might be a little up, might be a little down, and dividing it by the average teacher salary. There's no such thing as an average teacher. So it might not be 30, it might be 33, it might be 26.
Sure.
That's not five.
But I was surprised to hear a number like 30.
But even seeing a number like that to the average voter, oh, maybe we have 1,000 teachers in Reading.
Yeah.
They don't even know what that looks like.
Sure.
I like to think of it as elementary, middle, and high school.
Yeah.
You know, what does it mean at the elementary level? What does it mean at the high school?
Sure.
In very broad strokes. That's where I'm at.
Yeah. I think another part of the layout also is that, and I've heard this in a number of the sessions, you know, why are we just hearing about it now?
Yeah.
It's as if it, you know, kind of snuck up on us.
We're listening.
Well,
to be perfectly honest,
we have been talking about it. We have brought it up. But we have been discussing it, and it's a testament to a lot of town and school services that we've been able to manage as well as we have, particularly over the last few years, to minimize impacts of not being able to kind of level fund. And you know, it's tremendous we've gotten this far, but without being overly dramatic, it will have a very large impact in one direction or another. It's not that, well, let's just see what happens. That's, my view is against the financial welfare of the town.
Again, when you're presenting this to town meeting, and especially tomorrow night, don't use the word how long will this last? It lasts forever. I think what you should face is...
When will I get thirsty again is
yeah.
the question.
Yeah, that's or something like that. Yeah. When can we expect another override? How long do we anticipate this to before we need another override?
Yeah.
And I think Dan finally came up with agreeing with Dan and Tom Ryan that, you know, an override's forever, period.
Yeah.
Death and overrides, they're forever.
Unless there's an override.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah,
and
but
the day that happens,
or resurrection.
But remember, healthcare comes in between. And that actually is one of the big issues.
Yes.
No,
indeed.
No problem. Yeah. I know that. But
yeah.
I think I continue to hear, well, it's for the next 8 years. Well, no, an override is forever.
Oh, yeah. No, I think laying it out, as you guys have discussed, by piece, by year, and under scenario of yes and scenario of no.
Statement first, no rights forever, and then people will know.
Yeah.
You're going to vote on this forever.
Yeah,
but it doesn't solve the problem forever is
no.
probably the part that should be said that way.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, Vanessa.
I think there are three things that are worth emphasizing, or at least noting. For those people that are tuning in for the first time, mentioning the peer communities I think is relevant because for people that live in Reading that perhaps grew up in a place like Burlington or Woburn, the taxes here are going to seem disproportionately high. However,
yep.
to actual peer communities, we know where they stand. So, and I've heard some chatter about that as well. I think the point of what the impact will be if there is a no vote, as you mentioned, it's critical because people go, oh, it isn't just for extras. You know, people don't want, you know, gold-plated nameplates. These are the actual cost of what it is to run the town, as opposed to a new gymnasium or whatever people might be imagining. So I would recommend noting those items.
Could I add to that comment that someone asked me tonight, who are these 26 peer communities? Did you just cherry pick them? So it might be good to tell people what they are.
I just don't suggest we show, not tell.
Yes.
A slide that just has
except
the list.
I pointed out you have a very busy slide with a lot of names on it that
the,
no one could
the
read.
The best way is a map, just
yes.
to sort of get a sense of geography.
Yeah.
So most are
excellent.
Close by, many
yeah.
are not. Former government, we excluded cities.
Mm-hmm.
It was done by two consultants. The first one did 22, the second one added 3. Mathematically, I have a high degree of confidence in the first one. I'm not sure about the second one, he never explained it. But to answer one of Eric's questions, if we had not added those 3, I think they're Lexington, Concord, and Winchester.
No.
Instead of a $500 to $700 gap, what would it be? And I've said in the past it wouldn't be very much. It's actually $100, so it's not it's not, not nothing, but it doesn't change the basic conclusion.
Still 100 below.
So, no, it, instead of 500 to 700, it's 400 to 600.
Oh,
below.
Right.
So
yeah.
It's impacted.
Oh, so it's
$100
difference. Yeah, it's $100 difference.
I had thought it would be less, quite honestly, but it was just over $100 still.
And unintended consequence of this, I think there was another Mr. Brown that said he...
Peter Brown.
Huh?
Peter?
Yeah. That said something about giving up 2 pieces a week. Well, we do it,
oh, yeah.
The town will lose $99.
So you only cut back 1.5 pieces, is that what he's
saying? He's only paying for his pieces.
Let me just ask folks in the room a question about peer communities. I have a very simplistic presentation for tomorrow on purpose. The only thing I have about peer communities is that one chart showing the property tax bills with the regression. I don't have anything about, we have a lot of students, this is how we spend money, this is our revenues. Is any of that necessary, or is it really just, here's the property taxes?
I think if someone asks the question,
okay,
I have it available. I think
I'll have all my old stuff
with me
then. Yeah, it seemed like that would be too much at this point.
But coming to Vanessa's point, people need to understand, what's the cost to run the town? What have we done to reduce that cost already?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And this is kind of the why. You know, why are we here?
Yeah, I think I got that pretty much nailed. I'll tell you just one simple example, which we've said verbally, but it just with a slide all by itself, it really brings it out. In FY06, we had a certain policy of debt. We did, you know, 2 elementary schools inside the levy almost exclusively. If we had the same debt policy then, now, John and I would have $4 million less on the operating budgets in the current year to use. That's one of the financial policy changes we made that at the time was sort of a relatively small first step, but 10 years later, it's a big difference. We used to spend a lot of money on interest. Now interest rates were higher, but that's not the only reason. We used to borrow all the time. Bands don't even, you know, get a principal payment for as long as you can, was the philosophy. Don't pay it back. Just, you know, take as much time as you can. To me, having been on the other side of this coin managing money, interest is a completely dead asset. It's for the town. It's not producing anything. It's paying someone that lent you money. At least when you're paying back principal, you got something for it, and you just can't afford to pay it all back all at once. So our interest costs used to be over $1 million a year. They're now $300,000 a year. And again, if you move that forward, you know, it's all in all, it's worth $4 million plus the principal. So with just a couple simple examples of things we've done over the 10 years, it really drives the point home that we have made significant changes when you look back. Each piece at a time, like performance contracting, you know, who knows what that saved? Well, the answer is $400,000 or $500,000 a year in energy costs. So there's all these things we've done to change the way we are being managed. And again, I'm always open to ideas. I just don't have any anymore. You know, we'll probably come up with little ones, but not those big ones.
Well, does the future cash flow needs to be discounted? I mean, I know it's probably not a lot, but just to be technical.
That was the hardest adjustment coming from the private sector is no, you can't, and you shouldn't. Doesn't mean I don't intuitively, but now there's no such thing. There's no such thing as present value.
Okay.
It is bizarre.
Plus your discount rate is probably close to zero anyway.
Right.
Yeah, you tax people, so you don't have to worry. They have to pay.
But I mean, 2 points I just thought of. One, it might be nice to let people know what we are doing proactively from an economic development perspective, so that it's not, we're not reacting, but we are looking to the future to increase our commercial tax base. Also on that, for those people that are new to these discussions, discussing the splitting the tax rate with the commercial base and why it won't have a significant impact. to the individual tax rate?
Yeah, for the selectmen, we actually went over the economic development piece in some detail. And just to give you folks an order of magnitude, Walker's Brook is pulling in just over $2 million of commercial taxes a year. So if we could find a Walker's Brook 2, and we do have a plan for that, that may be $2 million a year, less whatever the services we have to provide might cost. And make no mistake, although John doesn't have as many costs down with Walker's Brook, from a public safety standpoint, we absolutely do. So, you know, maybe it's $1.5 million that we're clear, let's say, with Walker's Brook. That'd be great to have Walker's Brook too. That's the best we can do. That doesn't fix the $7.5 million problem. It may delay the next override a couple years if we can do it. But again, it, you know, unless we start literally buying up houses, knocking them down, and turning it into commercial, it's not going to happen. And we're actually discussing that in October.
I think these are, it has to be positioned, I think, these are ands, not ors.
Right, exactly.
You do all these things, right? And that's how you get there. There's not a magic solution.
And it's just even taken as a whole, we still have a structural deficit
right
from time to time.
Yeah.
Even if we do all those things.
Unless state aid would grow like health insurance and vice versa.
Reliably.
Then that'd be fine. We'd be all
yeah.
set.
Oh, I take that. The match?
No, have state aid go seven and a half and...
Oh, well, sure, even better. I was just thinking if we could get state aid to match health insurance.
If they matched, that would absolutely help. But the reverse would be great.
Yeah,
Bob, are you planning on proactively mentioning senior tax relief tomorrow or not?
I hadn't really thought about it. I hadn't put it in a presentation, but obviously I knew I'd have to have stuff ready. It's not really the point of tomorrow night
right.
at all.
But, it's connected.
But I'm sure there'll be some questions. So
I would suggest having a slide that shows total impact. So
yeah, the total impact is zero.
So my tax bill for an average household, how it breaks out
yeah.
by component, with
yep.
that being one of the components.
Okay.
Maybe
so
with
then,
a mid-range on the aid, maybe 100%
right.
or something.
Yeah, $81 for $500,000 house.
I think that what people want to know is, you know, I need to understand, if I'm here, I want to hear about it first, and then I want to talk about it.
Yeah, I will say from, and this is probably true with the selectmen, from the last month or so, the nature of the questions have gone from a relatively narrow, guessable range to completely wildly open. So it's impossible to anticipate what question might come in tomorrow. You wouldn't believe some of the questions I've seen.
That one will. I would be shocked if it didn't come up quickly.
And the question is, what is the purpose of tomorrow? Is it to answer every question? I don't know. I don't want to get too far off track, but we don't have a moderator. You know,
right.
We are it. So we'll do the best we can.
Do you want to try and see if Kevin?
No, we decided not to bother. Alan asked me, but I said no. I have no idea how many people are even going to attend.
I'll moderate, Bob.
All right.
805.
Fair bills.
There'll be no abstentions.
No.
And any comments from your side? It's like talking about spatial.
Thank you.
Let me answer a couple of Eric's questions then that I haven't got to. He asked about an increased OPEB contribution. Maybe that is a good idea and is discussed, but what Sharon and I have discussed is increasing the pension contribution. By $350,000 in the first year, and then it serves as a new baseline, if you will. That'll just get us finished with pension catch-up. To give you a round number, and this is definitely off the top of my head, I think we pay about $4 million a year in pension payments, pension funding. And if I remember correctly, $2.5 million of that is for past things we didn't do on time, and $1.5 million is for more current things. Once that $2.5 million goes away, our pension contribution, as required, drops significantly by $2.5-3 million at the time. The sooner we get to that, the sooner we can fund OPEB. So right now we're doing $500,000 a year. If this pension thing drops, by the time it does, if we just take the difference and don't stop, we can be fully funding OPEB at that point. But we're still talking about, I think it's 2028 or 29.
that pension is scheduled to.
When you're fully funded.
When you're fully funded,
yeah. Just
yeah.
to be clear, fully
right.
funding doesn't mean it's paid
doesn't
off.
Doesn't mean it goes away.
I'm making the right contribution
you're
per year.
Payment.
Right.
So that's the intent of that. Obviously, the $350,000 is a desire or a request or whatever. But if we're going to the trouble of adding more money, we think that's an important long-term liability. And honestly, you know, I know it's wrong not to be fully funding OPEB. And I know that someone in my position sitting here 30 or 40 years ago thought the same thing about pensions and no one did anything. So it's not a good thing that we're not doing it. And the answer that no one else is doing it virtually is not the best solution, because that, you know, unless someone decides to pass a law that says you don't have to, we're going to have to, just like pensions at some point. You're going to have to catch up. And then the idea of capital, I'll talk about that just a little bit. That I am going to talk about that tomorrow night. The capital plan that's going to September town meeting is balanced for 5 years, and then there's clearly a surplus shown of funding versus what's needed for the next 5 years. Now, a TLT settlement is not in those numbers. I don't know what it is. I have no idea. But the surplus over the years 6 to 10 is about $9 million versus current FinCom policy. So it seems to me a reasonable thing that we could cut the funding of capital after 5 years, let's just say. And if I looked at the annual, I'm doing it in my head, the annual run rate was something like a $2.5 million surplus in the 10th year, and it declined down to get to 9 total. So what I've proposed is to fund $2 million more in the first year, $2 million less in the 10th year, or the 8th year maybe, I guess it's the 8th year, and then scale it in between like a seesaw. So right now you're asking for $6 million for a $3 million funding gap. I should have brought a picture. It's a seesaw. You're saving money for 4 years, then you're spending it for 4 years. The extra $3 million you're asking for takes care of the 8 years, but it absolutely does not take care of the 10th year. So some people have said, why are you asking me for $6 million when you only need three and eventually you'll need six? Well, no, we're only asking for that because we need three now and we'll need nine almost in 8 years from now if this model's right, and I hope it isn't. So six is right in the middle. It takes care of that. But if that's what you do, and you save money in the first half and spend it in the second half, you've built a huge structural deficit at the end. And where our capital plan, and I've talked a lot to Joe, you know, I got to be careful what I say for a luck standpoint, but our facilities are in good shape.
Yeah, they are.
You know, other than Killam and the DPW bigger projects, broadly speaking, we've done a really nice job on facilities and in capital. And the same with our equipment. We have replacement schedules for equipment. You heard the chief tonight. It used to be we couldn't afford to do anything, so what's the most urgent need? And now everything's on a schedule. You know, maybe he doesn't need it in 10 years, maybe it's 11 or 12, not a big deal. But we do have, it's taken 10 years to catch up. And we still have another 5 years is what I'm telling you to really catch up. And then we're in a really good position on capital. So we can afford to, in the future, not have as much money allocated to capital. I guarantee you that's right. I don't know, maybe instead of 5%, it's 4%. I don't know the numbers. But wouldn't it be nice to additionally not just cut that, but do more up front? Because that way, especially, you know, for things that instead of doing it in year three, like the high school boiler, you know, instead of waiting 3 or 4 years, if it's going to save money in the operating budget, let's do that right away. We can easily identify $2 million in the next 12 to 24 months of things that would save money if we did them faster. So it seems like a really good idea. Instead of saving money, let's put it to a productive use. Then we don't have to spend it later when we're in a position to not need to spend it. So it, visually, it's pretty easy to see it. But it's a vexing question to someone that thinks you're asking for all $6 million now when you don't need it yet. And, you know, I understand. That's I think, the most difficult thing to explain about an override is the override does not fix the structural deficit by definition. It just buys you more time and less. Some of the basic assumptions about revenue and expenses change, and they aren't. You know, they haven't been. And one of the slides shows, and you've seen it before, for the last several years, why accommodated costs have actually been low. below 2% in many years, which has allowed a less than 3% revenue to actually translate to a more than 3% operating budget for most of the last few years. That won't happen in the future. It just can't. So there's some complex issues that I think visually will be pretty easy to see, you know, whether people believe them or not. I think that the key to tomorrow night is, as someone has said, is being as simple and straightforward as possible. And I'll make sure to have some of the things you talked about, and I think I'm going to add in some of the stuff you mentioned right into the presentation, but because you don't know what question might come up, we'll have to just have things to be ready with.
What do you think about the graph that shows kind of what Prop 2.5 does, the slope of that line? Of the reality of expenses at 3.5 and how overrides kind of.
I have one graph that shows expected revenues for 10 years and then expected operating budgets at 3.5% and expected accommodated costs. And the revenues and the 3.5% operating budgets are almost on top of each other because revenues are 3.2 up to 3.5. Mm-hmm. And then the accommodated cost thing is causing the gap.
Yep.
You know, 700 grand in the first year, 5.6 million after 8 years. So that's pretty easy to see and explain. And then I've actually drawn a middle right in the line right in the middle saying, here's the 3 million. In the front, you have a triangle that's savings. In this back, you have a triangle that's spending that savings. It's not hard.
Yeah. Yeah. I like that, but I was thinking something much more simplistic, not no breakdowns of anything. It's just a simple line that says, here's what Prop 2.5 allows to have happen over time, 2.5% growth. And then there's the reality of, here's where costs are best case, and you describe includes accommodated costs and health care.
It's similar to what I just described.
I'm just thinking that without breakouts, you can have the breakouts
okay.
You won't see the
operating budget line anyway, so we can just say here's costs.
That's the point. Yeah. It's just showing that here's what we've got coming in, here's where costs are.
Yeah, and the answer from me and the audience is all right, fix your costs.
And
that's why I show
slide.
What the costs are, like, you know, benefits, capital, debt,
right.
Energy, whatever. The things that, you know, we can't set what energy prices will be.
Nope.
Yeah, the Prop 2.5 does take care of our operating budget fairly closely. Better state aid would fix that, but some of the costs just aren't going to behave, and they haven't been, and they won't. Well, I shouldn't say they won't, I don't know that, but. You know, if you can imagine a scenario where health insurance starts dropping down to 1 or 2% a year, that'd be great. But I don't know anyone that thinks that.
Any other comments? So I think then, as it relates to Article 8 in the FinCom report, I'd like to share kind of my comments with a smaller group just to get some feedback. People are comfortable with that. I thought I would suggest maybe you want to join that group.
Yeah.
That's fine. Ann, you want to join?
I'm here.
Sorry. Feels like I'm talking like to the space shuttle or something. What I'm suggesting is that there'll be a FinCom report that'll be developed. I will write that report, but I'd love feedback from a kind of a subgroup. Ask me if you want to join that group.
Will there be in-person meetings required?
I think phone works.
Okay.
And email works even better.
Absolutely. Very good.
Cool. Okay.
Is phone working in compliance with the open meeting laws?
We won't have a quorum. We won't be a group under 4, under 5.
Okay. Just want to keep you guys honest.
We're trying. Okay, that's 8. We definitely have minutes. I wanted to do one other quick thing also. One is...
I also want to warn you that the warrant for November town meeting right now is 28 articles.
Wow!
And we will not be done before Thanksgiving.
Oh boy.
We start on the 14th.
Take one of those restaurants.
What I wanted to share with everybody is 10 articles if we wanted.
Two things. One is, if you remember in May, I think we had there was a meeting with town council. We had a discussion about what can and can't be done in terms of
political activity surrounding ballot questions. And there are two documents. One, it's a two-sided. One is kind of in written form. And then also on the town website, I'm not sure when it went up, but it's up there now, so that's most important, is another two-sided, which just kind of says, you know, yes, no. Can do this, can't do that. It's on the town website. I think it might even be under the override,
yes,
if I'm not mistaken. So you take a look at that. It does it graphically, which is kind of nice. Per the discussion that we had with town council before, FinCom is considered appointed policymaking. So that's kind of the column to be looking at in terms of activities that are okay to do, activities that are not okay to do. And I just want everybody to have that. We can talk more about it as time marches on, although kind of now is the right time to talk about it, just to make sure everybody's clear. What else did I have? I think that's it. Should we go to minutes? Sorry, before we do it, any other comments that you guests have for today?
No. Thank you.
No? Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you guys very much.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll add some of my discussion and send you another version.
So is this liaison assignment update? Is there something else you need to do?
No. Just for you,
okay.
We are just the tall stuff you discussed.
Good luck tomorrow.
Thank
that's
you.
Yeah. Let's take a look at minutes.
Okay.
We had two meetings worth. 6:29 and 8:24.
Eight. This should be 8:10.
Yeah.
I don't know why it says 8:24.
No,
the rest of it says 8:10, right?
I'm sorry, I missed that.
August 10th.
Should be August 10th.
August
10th. My header is August 10th.
Oh, yeah.
Did you guys have a private meeting?
That probably auto fills the
content. Oh yeah, that does. Every time you open it up, it changes the date.
It's interesting, you look at these comments on page 13. And it talks a little bit about, you know, what we just discussed, the override, tell the residents about why the reserves have changed, to show the running tax bills compared to surrounding communities, and get here from this management. Not a bad element. Is everybody through the first one?
Yep.
Any comments, fixes?
Should you approve the minutes?
Do the first one. I'll start with the 6:29.
Am I voting on that one since I wasn't there?
Yeah, that would be good if you didn't.
Yeah, I think that was a no.
You better abstain.
Should
you abstain? Since Bill is left.
Yeah. Yeah.
He doesn't. He can't even do that. Actually, you can, but probably be in best form. Just say nothing.
Okay. So, motion to approve the minutes of June 29th.
You have a second?
Second.
That's the second. Discussion, changes, nothing. All right, Paul.
Yes.
Peter.
Yes.
So should I not call on her?
Yeah.
I'm not calling. David.
Yes.
Vanessa.
Yes.
Mark. Yes. Ann.
Yeah.
So we go as, 601.
Don't call me on the second one.
Approval. Okay, let's read the second one quickly. Do we want to change the word on page 13, that Mr. Malnota, the town didn't get it from mismanagement, our last override lasted much longer than it should have? It should be much longer than it was thought to.
Well, that is an interesting way to say it.
How about much longer than
it might have?
Than it was, than it might, than it.
Than it was anticipated.
Than it was anticipated the last four.
If they anticipate. If, yeah.
Be worse if it was the other way around.
Right.
Didn't last nearly as long as it should have.
But David, he wasn't present or not present at the meeting.
Oh, yeah, we gotta add you to the not present list, David. So on the 810, we'll add David to not present. Yeah, you do the count.
Yeah, okay. Exactly.
What if they said should have been expected?
David with the
no.
No.
Back to the old
one. I liked it on the other one. Our last override lasted much longer than it was anticipated the last override.
But they anticipated. No,
should have been
expected.
Right.
I don't know. It was a lot of stuff, but we don't have to worry about what we attribute.
Looks like Mark talked a lot last meeting.
What else did he say? How about just then was expected? Our last override lasted much longer than was expected.
Okay.
It's just simple.
I think Mark would
probably do that. So David was not only not present, he was expected to be present.
Okay. So we'll change the.
As expected.
Yeah. Okay. Mr. Maul, on page 13.
Yep.
Mr. Maul, no, the town didn't get here from mismanagement. Our last override lasted much longer than was expected. Beautiful, simple. Anything else? All good?
Motion to approve the August 24th minutes as amended.
August 10th.
Yes.
Sorry.
With that.
Which I'll change.
Sorry. So.
Eric seconds. Discussion? No. All right. Paul?
Yes.
Peter?
Yes.
Eric?
Yes.
David? Oh, you weren't there, but you still have to do something.
He's neither present nor
okay,
absent.
Okay, we'll leave it. All right, no answer.
I said don't call me.
Sorry. Vanessa?
I abstain. I wasn't intended to.
Okay. Mark? Yes. Anne?
Yeah.
So we are 5-2. 5-0-2. Any other business, guys,
I think
tonight?
Of the fifth one being absent from our physical presence counts. I'll look into that.
I'm not sure. It's a good question.
I thought
it was just related to quorum, not to votes.
I know it's quorum. It does have some influence on votes, but I'm not sure.
I can bring it back up.
So you might be looking at the minutes again someday, just
that's
in case.
I don't think we'll change that.
I'll just write it up this way. No one's going to ever figure it out.
Any other business? No, all good. No other business.
Motion to adjourn.
We have a second.
Second.
Sorry.
Yes.
Peter.
Yes.
Eric.
Yes.
David.
Yes.
Vanessa.
Yes.
Mark. Yes. Anne.
Yeah.
We are adjourned.
Thanks, Anne.
Thank you, everybody.
Good luck. Yeah.